All right. How do we develop that skill of surfacing mentally and presenting to them the scenarios of how the biblical truth connects with their life? That brings us to the middle of page 2. The way to be relevant, the way to make those contemporary connections, to discover what they are. First of all, start with thinking of how would this truth show up in my life, okay? You live in the same human framework that they live in. Where in your life, in your experiences, in your relationships, where would this truth show up? For example, let's suppose your biblical passage has something to do with anger, okay? Now, in the biblical world, there are two kinds of anger. The one that your passage is on the second one. The first kind of anger, which is not what your passage is about, first kind of anger is that destructive hatred anger. The anger which looks at another person and says, if I could wipe you off the face of the earth, I would, I hate you. You know, it's that destructive, it's that murderous anger. Okay, that's not the one. The second kind of anger, and this is the one in your passage, it's the anger of frustration, the anger of impatience. Okay, where does that show up in my life? When do I experience that? Here's one time. Tell me what's happening.
At the grocery store.
What's my problem?
You have 11 items. Forgot your pen.
The sign says 10, 15 items or less. I counted 32 in your box. Get out of this line! Now, when do you have that feeling of irritation, frustration? When does it show up in your life? Give me another example. Give me two more examples.
When an old person cuts me off on the road.
Did you say an old person?
Actually, a short old person.
Would the gender be relevant? Okay. All right. In a Southern California freeway, if all of a sudden it comes to a stop, and it stays stopped, I know there is an accident a half a mile up, and I'm going to be here for 5 hours. Oh, here's another one. Tell me what's happening. What just happened?
You forgot to hit save.
Huh?
You forgot to hit save.
I forgot to hit save. Or computer error. Document may be lost. That's my sermon! Or you get in one of those telephone loops, or you can never get a live person, okay? And they're bouncing you from menu to menu to menu to menu to menu. And then all of a sudden, they've lost you. And you gotta start all over. And you can't pick it up where you lost it. You gotta go through the whole route. Okay, so you're nodding your head, you're nodding your head. Why is he nodding his head and smiling? He sees it! All of a sudden, a mental picture, the experience, and the emotions are starting to go. Okay, where does it show up in your life? Start with that, all right? Then the next thing to do is to say, where does it show up in the lives of my people? And here, you're gonna start thinking through the different kinds of people that you're talking to. The demographics, the genders, the life situations. And you're gonna run through it. Now, you start off with thinking, who am I talking to? Well, obviously, men, women, teenagers, maybe children, maybe they're in the children's church. But the men, now that's just a huge category. You got to break it down into subcategories, because these men have different hats or roles that they wear. Okay, what hats or roles do men have in life? They are men, but as men, they are fathers, some of them. Some of them are not fathers. They are husbands, not all of them. But even those categories break down. You got to keep breaking it down into subcategories. They are fathers, some of them, but they are not all the same kind of father. Some of them are fathers of emptiness. They are fathers who are 70, and they are worried about their 50-year-old son who is not raising their grandchildren correctly, right? Or they are fathers of girls, not boys. Or they are fathers of five children, not fathers of one children. Or they are natural fathers and not stepfathers. I mean, they're just all kinds of subcategories. The same is true if you start thinking of them in terms of husbands. Some of them, are you a husband? You're not a husband. All right. Are you a husband?
Yep.
How long?
6 years.
6 years. Are you a husband?
I am.
How long?
55 years.
All right. Is there any difference between a husband that long as opposed to a husband 6 years?
Doing it right, you're doing it wrong. Or we're supposed to be the other way around.
It's just they're just not in the same category.
Glad you got
it. Is he a first husband or a second husband? A second husband has a whole different set of concerns to be aware of that first husbands do not enter. There's the second husband might be thinking, am I being compared favorably or unfavorably to the first husband, whether the first husband is divorced or even dead, okay? The second husband, are there children? I'm trying to be a stepdad to the children. Are they allowing me to do so, or do they resent me in the family, okay? There's all kinds of subcategories, and we just keep breaking it down until we strike, that's where the truth is. There's where it is. And so we rummage around in their lives. We do the same thing with the women. Are they widows? Are they newlyweds? Are they mothers with high school students that no longer communicate with them? Okay. What categories are they in? So we just keep breaking it down. Most of them have a work function, okay? They have jobs, okay? Some of them are white-collar jobs, some of them are blue-collar jobs, some of them are agricultural jobs, some of them are heavy equipment jobs, some of them are desk jobs, some of them are dangerous jobs, law enforcement, fire kinds of things. They all have different categories. Now let's just rummage around in what this would look like in a person's work, okay? Let's imagine that somebody owns the business. It could be a mom and pop store, it could be a small tech company, whatever it is, he's the boss. If you own the business, what do you have to think about if you own the business? What do you have to concern yourself with? What shows up if you're the owner? What's one thing you have to?
Bottom line.
All right, bottom line. Okay, how do I get to it? Is it sufficient? Good, give me another one. What else do you have to worry about?
Payroll.
Okay, I gotta meet the payroll. And with that comes taxes and insurance and stuff like that. Good, what else?
Employees.
Employees, big category. That one has subcategories. Because when you think about your employees, you have to think about what in terms of them?
Benefits,
good, what else? Morale. What else?
Training.
Finding, firing, retaining. Good. All of those things are in there. Okay, what else?
Marketing.
Huh?
Marketing.
Marketing, which involves what subcategories?
Cash flow.
What? Where will I put the money? Will it be billboards? Will it be newspapers, TV?
Channels.
Yeah.
Communication channels.
Good. Good. All right. You've got competition. If you own the business, you've got competition that you're fighting with. You've got to worry about the obsolescence of either your service or your product. You've got to worry about governmental red tape. Okay, all of these things are factors if you own the business. Okay, now most of the people that you're talking to probably don't own their own business. They probably work for somebody. So let's imagine that you're talking to people and they work for somebody and they're just not really happy with the job. Okay, they're there for, and they're kind of probably going to be there for a while for a number of reasons that are worthy reasons. Maybe that there are a limited number of jobs in the field and they're going to stick with the one they got. Maybe for health reasons of either them or somebody in the family or an aged parent, they need to stay in the area. So moving to another is not an option. Maybe it's too late to learn some new function or go to school. Whatever it is, they're in a job, but you know, they're kind of counting the days until they can retire and hope they'll have enough money to do it. They don't like the job. Okay? Now, why are they unhappy with the job? Okay? You've got something encouraging from the Word of God. You're like James, you're not like Paul, you know, as he spoke to those who were serving others. He says, if you can get your freedom, do so. But if you are compelled to stay where you are, then here is how to carry out the work. You want to bring that message, but you need to identify a person who is unhappy for some particular reason. Now, why would somebody be unhappy with their job?
Policies.
What?
Policies.
Policies. Polity? No.
Policy.
Policy.
Policies. Okay, now watch what I'm going to do. That is a great large category, but I don't see any pictures because the word policies is a vague abstraction. So I say to you, what policy do you have in mind? Notice, I'm asking him to get concrete, to get specific. So what would be a policy that the company has that he doesn't like or thinks is wrong? See, so you would have to pin one down.
Inflexibility of scheduling.
Scheduling.
Their hours.
Their hours, okay. Now I've got something concrete. They are forcing me to work from 7 o'clock until 3 a.m. and they won't give me another shift or something like that. Now I'm getting a picture, you see? So you come up with a great category, but it can't be vague or abstract. You've got to get inside that category and give a concrete example. Okay, that's one good example. Why else might they be unhappy besides inflexibilities of work schedule?
Personality conflicts with boss or superiors.
All right. Such as?
That could be an example, work hours, style of work, overbearing control, micromanagement.
There you go. Now we're getting there.
Yeah.
That's it. All right. When you say personality conflicts, he might think or she might think of the one that they have. But if she's sitting there and I think, and all of a sudden you start giving those, it's like, oh yeah, oh yeah, okay? And you could go into that, there's all kinds of examples under that. He hires his nephew right out of high school and puts him in a position over me. What kind of nepotism is that? Or I know the boss, I know this job better than the boss does. He's always trying to tell me how to do it. Okay, all kinds of good. Why else, Mike? We've got two great ones. Give me some more. They don't like the job. Why?
They don't think they see their kids enough.
They don't think they see their kids enough.
Yeah.
Why?
They don't think that their work allows them to, maybe.
Okay. Is it a distance issue or an hours issue?
They have an hour drive home from work.
You know? Okay. Ah. Now I'm getting a picture. It's the commute. The commute
means they leave before the kids get up or get off to school. And by the time I get home, the kids are either doing their homework or off to bed. Good. All right, the commute. What else? They don't like the job. Why?
Not enough pay.
Not good. Not enough pay.
Don't
what else?
Feel valued.
Huh?
Don't feel valued.
All right. Not appreciated. Good. It could be that there are safety issues. It's a dangerous occupation which requires you up high on something or working around asbestos or who knows what. Okay. Why else might they not like the job?
Boss.
Huh?
Their boss.
Their boss. What about their boss don't they like?
Personality, how they do their job.
Okay. He could be crude. He could be sexually offensive to the women, making innuendos or saying things that they wish he wouldn't say or watching them with his eyes when he shouldn't be. Yeah, could be all kinds of things. Okay. All right. Now, let's imagine that they what else could they not like about their job?
Don't feel purpose.
Purpose? No advancement? Dead end? It could be dirty work of some sort, and I don't mean soiled, I mean immoral, lucrative, but their soul is shriveling. Good. All right. All right, let's go to another area. Maybe we go through this whole work area and can't see anything that comes up. Well, let's try, what does it look like? What does it look like in their dwelling situations? Okay. Yeah, it's here somewhere. Well, you got it on your sheet of paper. Some people own their own home. Some people rent. Some of them live with their parents, and some of them have roommates. Now, that's four different separate categories. If you own your own home, what do you have to be concerned about, think about? But rummage around. You own the home.
Maintaining the property.
What?
Maintaining the property.
All right, you are responsible for all the yard work, all the painting, all the repairs or anything. Good. What else, if you're the homeowner, do you have to concern yourself with?
Specials.
Yeah. What do you mean by
special tax assessment?
What kind of specials are we talking about?
Well, when there's like road work you'd be done, you'd be paying for that, right?
Okay.
Certain beautifications.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Assessments.
Give me another one. Good. You own the home.
Maintenance.
Okay, we've kind of picked that up with our repairs. What else?
Making payments.
All right, you've got mortgage payments probably. If not for sure, you've got tax, at least I assume you have property taxes. Good. What else? You own the home.
Aging materials. Aging finishes, materials, appliances.
Aging, okay. You have to replace all that. You've got rusting pipes that are good. You might have termites, foundation issues. Yeah, good. Okay, these are all your responsibility. What else?
Increasing property taxes.
Yes. How does that work in your state? Just the value of the house means the property taxes?
Oh yeah, I live in Maryland, taxes are high.
Okay. Yeah. Years ago in California, we had Proposition 13. And it said, because at that time, houses were increasing in value to the point where the widow who owned the house could not afford the increased taxes, and they were losing their home. And so the law was passed that your house, your property tax, regardless of the equity on your house, your property tax could not go up more than 2% a year. And they froze how much it was. Now, if you bought a new home, all of a sudden you started at that value of that home and on it. But if you stayed in the same home where you bought it, you could count it back to then. So, but property taxes were, people were losing their homes because of that. Good. What else?
Insurance. Insurance. House insurance.
Who?
Insurance.
Insurance. Different kinds. Property insurance, homeowners insurance.
Neighbors.
Neighbors. Yeah. Okay. Are they keeping up the property values of the neighborhood? Do they have a dog that barks all night long? Oh, you left. You see what he did? He went, okay. All of a sudden, he saw what that would be like. One of the men in our church was talking about a neighbor that had a barking dog all the time. And he was asking me, the pastor, what he should do about it. I said, poison some meat. You might do that. Okay. All right. Now, a lot of the people that they don't own their home, they are renting. Okay? Now, what's in your mind if you are a renter? So you're rummaging around because you want to connect with something that's in the part of their experience. If you're a renter, what do you have to be thinking about?
Landlord.
What?
Landlord.
Landlord. All right. Big category. Why is the landlord important? Landlord. Break it down. Subcategory, 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 subcategory. You have to think about the landlord because?
To keep him happy.
You have to keep him happy. What do you mean by keeping him happy?
It's not your property.
Well, what does that mean? You have to
pay the rent on time?
Pay the rent on time. Not damage the building. Okay, good. Why else is the landlord important? Not only because you have to make sure he's of a good frame of mind.
Because you don't have authority to fix things yourself. The landlord has to do that for you, and they may not always do it.
And he may not be responsive. He just is real slow about calls that we have that the toilet is overflowing or the sink is clogged up or the washing machine is broken down or you name it. Good. Excellent. He's not responsive. What else?
You got to hide the dog, the fish, and the three cats every time he comes over. It's inconvenient.
You're not suggesting there's a no pets rule, are you? All right. Another a broader way of saying is he makes the rules. He makes the rules whether you can have pets, when your kids can use the swimming pool in the apartment complex. He makes the rules. Okay. What else?
Nosy.
He's nosy. Does he have a key to your apartment? Oh, probably. Do you ever come home and think that maybe he's been there while you've been gone? Okay. The landlord, big category. All right, what else if you're renting?
The rent may go up.
The rent could go up. Mortgages don't unless you have a variable, and even then there's a cap on it. But some states have laws about how much the rent can go up. He can also evict you. He may be required to give you a certain amount of notice, but he could sell the property and the new owner could turn it into condos and you lose your apartment or whatever kind of a thing. All kinds of insecurities are attached to the amount of money and this permanence with which you're there. To say nothing of the fact that you're not making any equity for the future. You're not building an asset. The rent money isn't doing any of that for you, okay? There could be safety issues, okay? Maybe the parking is under a covered shed outside and at night in the dark, you have to walk half a block to get into the building. Or maybe the laundry room is in the other unit in the basement. How do you feel about your wife or your daughter doing laundry at 10 o'clock at night, two floors down and 100 yards away? All kinds of issues if you are the renter, okay? And then the neighbors become even more important if you're a renter, because they are either up there or down there or next to you. And you're hearing noise all the time. There is somebody who is stomping, there are drums that are being played, all kinds of stuff going on, okay? And all of your people are connected. If they are renters, then they are saying yes, 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 okay? Now, some of them live with their parents, okay? They're 25 years old, they graduated from college,
They are back in the home looking, trying to find work. Maybe they've even found work, but they are not yet able to afford their own living accommodations. All right, if you're 25 years old and you're living with your parents, what do you have to think about?
Or what video game to play?
Okay, man, I need to get my question finished. Can I bring my date home? Can we sit on the couch and watch TV without mom coming and joining us? Okay, good. What else?
Something I personally had to deal with, not micromanaging the life of a grown son who's living with me, but at the same time letting them feel autonomy, but they're responsible to obey house rules.
That's
certain
right.
things they can't do, but I'm not trying to be a dad of an adult. It's a house rule. How do you negotiate that?
Yeah.
That's a
Give us an example of the house rule.
Bringing people home would be an example, like what times they would do that, or neatness, keeping things neat, cleaning up the kitchen after eating.
Good.
Or do they expect mom and dad to do that? Things like
that. Terrific. See, the specifics suddenly give you the reality of what he's talking about. When you just talk about how do I parent an adult child, yeah, we understand there's probably some difficulties there, but all of a sudden we see the difficulties. One of my difficulties was you show up for breakfast, you don't come into the kitchen and disturb the kitchen at 10 o'clock in the morning after we've cleaned it up after breakfast. This was a college son who was home during the summer and not out looking for work. That was the kind of thing. I finally said to him, Peter, I'm going to take you and deposit you on a corner at 8 o'clock. I will come back to that corner at 5 o'clock and pick you up. What you do, I hope it will be productive while you look for work. All right. What else? You live with parents. Okay. You go on a date. Your date says, where do you live? I'm sorry, where do you live? I live with my parents. Now, what is a legitimate reason for living with your parents, which now makes you look noble instead of a loser?
Going to seminary, spares to
I'm going to think his answer had wider application. Was it?
I'm renting the upstairs to them.
Okay. I'm helping them with the mortgage. I'm paying considerable amount. Or, even more importantly sometimes, health issues that they have, and my being in the house is to keep an eye on them and help them out. I'm there as a dutiful child to do that. That's a reason, okay? All right, these are all issues. You know, what expectations? Mom, Dad, I'm going out. Where are you going? I'm gonna meet some friends. We're gonna go somewhere. Well, where are you gonna go? I don't know, we'll decide when we get there. What time will you come home? I don't know. Well, you won't be late, will you? Mom, I just got out of the army, okay? Don't worry, I can take care of myself. Okay, it's this hovering at an age when I'm an independent adult, okay? Now, what about roommates? We're rummaging around. You got people who have roommates. If you have a roommate, what do you got to be concerned about?
Who does the dishes?
Who does the dishes? To say nothing of the other chores. Good. Who does the vacuuming? Who does the whatever? Good. What else?
Who's food in the refrigerator? You eat somebody else's food or your own food?
Yeah, who ate my chicken leg that I had in there? Yeah. Which shelf is yours? Which shelf is mine? Okay. Maybe who cooks which meals? Good, good. Who closely to the refrigerator is who wore my sweater without asking me? Okay, good. What else? Roommates. Big category still.
Can I bring my date home?
Can I bring my date home? Or my date wants to bring, my roommate wants to bring his girlfriend overnight in his room. Now we got a problem. Okay, what else? paying their share of the rent.
Well, yeah.
Okay? I mean, I go to the landlord and I say, here's my half of the rent. You'll have to get it from my roommate. What's the landlord's answer? You are contractually responsible for all of the rent. You get it from your roommate. If not, you give me the whole thing. If you don't give me the whole thing and he doesn't pay, you're both out of here. So all of a sudden, if I've got a deadbeat roommate on the rent, I'm on the pony for the double amount that I expected to pay. So that becomes pretty important. All right, we're rummaging around, okay? Work. Houses. Well, let's go into their marriages. We've got people who are newlywed. Got people who are midlife marriage. They've been married 20, 30 years. We got some people who are in the last years of their marriage. They're knowing that soon one of them is going to be leaving, okay? Now, a whole different set of concerns. Newlyweds, what do they have to think about, concern themselves with?
Adjusting to each other, getting along.
All right, adjusting to each other is wonderful category. A little vague, not sure to see what you're talking, thinking about. Give me a specific. What adjustments do they have to make?
Money.
Money. Go deeper. What do you mean by that? Why do they have to?
What? Who pays for what? Do we mingle our money? Do we keep separate accounts?
All right, now you're talking.
More than she does.
All right, you got a good list there. She's been handling her own checkbook for the last 5 years as a single gal. You want to take over handling the family finances? I got A plus in junior high math. What did you get? C minus? Why are we letting you handle the checkbook? Okay. Or she's been making her own investments. Now all of a sudden he wants to control that. Or he was used to going out and buying whatever he wanted. She's much more of a let's budget, let's save. Why are you spending money on a gun for the back of your pickup truck when we need to buy a refrigerator or something like that? Okay. All kinds of adjustments in the money. Good. What other adjustments do they have to make?
Intimacy expectations.
Expectations about what?
About intimacy.
Huh?
Intimacy.
Oh, intimacy. Okay. Yeah. How often? What? Yeah. Even sleeping, hopefully sleeping in the same bed is an adjustment. You're used to now you can't do that anymore. It takes you several months to get used to sleeping with somebody, hopefully, when you get married, somebody else. All right, what else?
How's my cohabitation affecting my marriage?
How is my cohabitation?
Life with her. Now we're married.
Before you were living together beforehand? I'm not sure I got the word cohabitate.
So you lived with your spouse, who's now your spouse. You were living together before you got married.
Ah.
Now you are married.
Okay. What's all right. There? Yes. Yeah. That's a good one. Yeah. Okay.
Where do you spend the holidays?
Oh. Oh my, flesh that out. My goodness, that's a big one.
Good luck to you. Alternate Thanksgiving, Christmas, Easter 1 year with this family, Easter the next year with that family.
Yeah. Big issues. Adjusting to in-laws in general. Which ones are welcome to visit, which ones you hope will stay where they are. Okay, the interference of in-laws and children. When are you going to have children? Why haven't you had children? Yeah. All right, let's now go to the middle years. They've been married 20, 30 years. What are the concerns that they have? What's showing up?
Maybe adjusting to
retirement.
Empty nest. Okay, what else?
One of the spouses retires and is around all the time.
Okay. I heard one woman gave me a definition of retirement. She said, half as much money, twice as much husband. What else? Maybe knowing that And even if you're still in the workforce, you have plateaued. You're never going to get the dream that you had, the position you had, the scale or whatever it is. You've hit your limit, okay? That happens at times. What else?
Taking care of your in-laws.
Okay. And sometimes you're the sandwich generation. You've got kids going off to college and you've got parents who need financial help. And you're caught in between at the same time you're trying to build your own retirement. Good. What else?
So I actually put kids because me and my wife have been married for 17 years and we have two kids.
Yeah.
And 3 and 5. So I think a lot of people are just starting out right now with kids. So I guess we got to wait and see what happens.
Yeah.
What other kind of issues will come up over the years.
Good. Good. You have either children who are in their late teens. Most people have been married as long as you have. Maybe they are off to college. And maybe also you see them making choices that you wish they wouldn't be making. Okay? Some of them are not convinced that they want to follow the Christian faith. Some of them are engaged in destructive behaviors physically to themselves with drugs. Some of them are living a licentious lifestyle. A lot of sorrows that accumulate during those times. Also during these years, the consideration of, does my spouse look physically attractive to me? You know, do we still enjoy the marriage bed and the joys of it? Or is this something that is very seldom engaged in any longer? Certain health issues start to show up. And that moves us into the sunset years. Health becomes a real issue at that point, okay? You see diseases or you see conditions that you know are degenerative and are coming on, okay? You also have financial concerns. Now that we're no longer bringing in money is what we have arranged for through IRAs or pensions or savings or equities. Is there enough for the number of years that are ahead? And we're not sure, we don't know, okay? There's also the decision at that time of where do we live? Do we try to get closer to our kids, to be around them in our old age? Some of my friends are moving into, in California, we have these retirement kind of centers where you move in when you're healthy and they see you into the grave, but you paid a premium price for that up front. But they'll make sure you have all the medical attention that you need as you age. But in the early stages, you're eating in a common room with other people and so on like that. So these are decisions that they're making. What else is a factor in your old age that's showing up?
Will my spouse remember me?
Will my spouse remember me? Yeah, dementia, Alzheimer's. The other thing I noticed with my mother, her social circle was diminishing and dying off, okay? The people that she went to church with all her life, which that number was getting fewer and fewer. Limited interaction with people at that thing. Okay, we're just rummaging around. Let's take another category. Number 4 there, persecution for righteousness' sake. There are a lot of times when in preaching the Bible, you will come across something to the effect of, blessed are you when you are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Okay, you see it in the Beatitudes, you see it in Peter, it shows up frequently, that there will be times when you will do the right thing, righteousness, and you will end up paying a price. And you will know that going into it. You will know that if you do the right thing, you are going to get hammered. You're going to get consequences. And you have a choice. I can either shrink back from doing the right thing and go along and avoid any unpleasantness, or I can do what the biblical command is or what the Spirit of God wants me to do, and I know when I do it, I'm going to get persecuted. Okay? Blessed are you when you are persecuted for acting righteously. All right. How would that show up in their lives? Being blessed for a person being persecuted, okay? Now, you two right there, you two tables, you'll turn around. You're going to give me three or four examples of how it would show up in the life of a widow that you're talking to in your church. She's a mother of the church. She's been there for a long time. Her husband left her financially okay, so money is not an issue, okay? She's admired by the people in the church, okay? A godly woman. She's in her late 70s, early 80s. How would she find herself faced with a decision where she's going to act righteously and she knows she's going to pay a price for doing it? I want several examples about a widow. Okay? You will give me a businessman. You two tables back there. Let's say he works for, it's a white collar job, large corporation. He's got a middle management position. He's a valued employee. But all of a sudden something is, he has to make a decision. If I do what I'm being asked to do or what I'm expected to do, it will go against my conscience, against God's laws. But if I don't do it, I'm going to pay a price as far as this company is concerned. Okay? Let's see. I got a young lady here, so I'm going to take advantage of it. You three, you talk about a young mom, okay? She's a stay-at-home mom. Her husband has a good job. I've got to stay behind this microphone, sorry. She has a high school son. She's got a 12 or 13 year old daughter, and she's got a 4 year old toddler at home, okay? They're buying their house. They attend a good church. As a pastor, you wish all young couples in the church were as good as this couple. All right, here's a young mom. My husband loves me. My neighbors, I get along well with them. My children are not a problem. Persecuted for righteousness' sake? I don't know. Now, how can you put a picture in her head, two or three pictures, of where persecution may come her way? Okay? All right? You all have college students. Okay? Where would persecution for righteousness' sake show up? Maybe a high school student. Somebody who's basically a school person. Okay? Where would it show up for them? You all have a neighbor. Neighborhood. You're in a neighborhood. Or you can take a family relative. Okay? Either way. Relationships with your relatives. Let's take that. That's easier than neighbors. Neighbors are, there are fewer to connect with. You've got family relatives. Where would persecution for righteousness' sake show up where you do something that you know God wants you to do and it strains the relationship with the relatives or produces hostility or disrupture or estrangement? Okay? You've got that. Now, talk it over. After a few minutes, I'm going to ask you to share the examples you've come up with the group. All right? Go ahead.
therefore she might lose some money or
okay.
some Social Security.
This is a great example. If two elderly people who are widows and they each have Social Security, if they marry, our government will penalize them. It'll take away one of their Social Securities. And so the temptation is for them just to live together and keep both of their finances, okay? And in fact, some churches have gone around this and they have some sort of a blessings ceremony, which is a way of acknowledging to the church, these people want to do something that the Lord can bless, but they're trying to keep it out of the eyes of the government. I'm not sure it's a nice thing for churches to do. And in fact, pastors are in a moral quandary as to whether to go along with something like this, knowing that they want to help their parishioners financially, but also their own conscience says, we're going against a government. If the government found out about this, we couldn't pass muster on it. But it's a tremendous temptation. Good. What else?
Only wanting hymns in the church.
Only wanting hymns in the church.
Yep.
Now, why will she get persecuted for that?
Because that's what she wants.
That's what she wants.
That's what she wants.
Who's going to persecute her?
Everybody, all these people right here.
Okay. Shame on you. All right. She thinks that's a righteous desire, huh? Okay. What else?
We have children not liking choices, like moving to a new location, or not all children are Christian, and so she wants to make reference of faith.
Her righteous action is what?
Oh, preaching the gospel to her unfaithful children.
And the persecution she gets for that is?
The children are telling mom, be quiet.
Yeah, bug out, mom. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Good. See, you want to make sure we've got two categories. We've got a righteous action, knowing that if I do it, I'm going to get pushback of some sort. Good. These are great. What else?
Isolation because of faith. The world around me is changing. My friends are having different choices. So social life is starting to dwindle.
Good. Good.
The way she uses her finances, maybe, that she has remaining, and she gives more to the church rather than to her family.
Pastor, she wants to give $85,000 to your building program. Is that okay with you?
Yes. 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 Yes.
Okay. Who is it not okay with?
Her kids.
That's their inheritance. All right. Hey, that's great. Those are really good. All right. Okay, who'd you all have?
So the first one we thought it was time cards. So you got your boss leaves early on a Friday, and everybody in your company gets together and said, "Hey, we're leaving right after he leaves, and we're gonna put down on our time cards we were here for 8 hours." What do you do?
All right.
If you're the only one that goes correct, then you're gonna get everyone in trouble.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, since the boss is not there. And since their time card will show the same exit as my time card, I'm not sure I see how I've gotten them in trouble.
Well, so if everyone puts 8 hours, but you put six, and then they go, wait.
Ah, if
Why
I leave all
six on there, everyone else has eight.
Okay.
Because we left at noon.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. What if I stay the entire time while they go home? Then it doesn't happen. But your example works good.
Yeah.
That's good. All right. I just wanted to clarify. I want to get a good picture of it. What else you got?
We've got taking responsibility for a bad business deal that maybe you created, saying it's your fault.
Wow.
Yep.
Now, that's the righteous thing and a lesser role in the company as a result. Yeah, maybe a demotion or who knows what.
Yeah.
If not, yeah. Good. What else?
We've got bad handwriting. It's mine too.
Yeah.
Admitting an error with your order. It's kind of the same thing, but we're going for specifics. Being asked to cover up for a scandal at work.
Okay. All right, can you give me a little bit more defined picture? The scandal is what, and I'm being asked to do what?
Yeah, the boss is cooking the books, and you know he's cooking the books, and he's saying, but we just can't talk about this right
yeah.
now.
Yeah, okay. All right, that gets much more concrete. Good.
Yeah.
These are good, really good. Your boss, you're a pretty up high in the corporate ladder, and the boss over you, the CEO or something, says we've got a delegation from the Middle East coming. They're interested in doing some business with our company. They've let it be known that they would like us to arrange some female companionship for them while they're here. Would you take care of that, please?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's not yet.
Yeah. Agreeing.
Yeah, it's a good example. Okay. All right. I mean, yeah, these are the kinds of things where righteousness will do it. Okay, who you all got?
Huh? You skipped over us.
I skipped over you.
Yeah, it's okay.
My apologies. I am so sorry.
Good job, Luke. Well, ask them what they did with their time.
All right. I know you all had young wives, young mothers.
No, we did. We're too real long. Okay. No, they didn't. We got some. So we came up with, imagine you're invited to a group of other mothers with children, and they start talking poorly about their husbands, and you feel that you should maybe say, I don't want to talk that way about my husband, and then face the being ridiculed and put out of
you're ostracized.
Yeah.
Good example. Another one.
Well, but kind of the flip side of that one, it's kind of the same thing, but opposite, where you feel the pressure from other Christians in your church to put your kids in a Christian school or homeschool, but your child has special needs, and none of those options meet their needs, so you have to put them in a public school setting.
That's a good example. I hadn't thought about that, but that is good. Certain churches, some churches have a culture of expectation. You put your kids in our church school, you homeschool, you put your kids in public schools to be salt and light, whatever it may be, it can be different churches. Mm-hmm. And if you don't go along with that culture of that church, then you are not on the inner circle of that church. That's good, good. What else? Got another one?
Some of the kids in the neighborhood are getting together to enjoy the one kid's got a brand new Ouija board, and your kids want to go and play with the new game too.
Good.
So the parent says, maybe not.
Right, and the persecution will come where?
Probably from the other parents.
That's
right.
Aware
that they can't come.
Good, good.
Who do you think you are?
Yeah, who are you judging us? Good. Another one might be that she will let her kids go to the beach with her in-laws for 2 weeks. But she will not let her kids go to the mountain, with her parents for 2 weeks, she will not let them go to the mountain cabin with her in-laws for 2 weeks. And her husband supports her. Her parents are believers. Her in-laws are not. She doesn't want her high school son to see the pornography that her father-in-law has in that cabin. Not even sure she can trust her father-in-law with her 14-year-old daughter. Okay? Her husband supports her, but boy, does she hear it from the in-laws that they won't. She won't let her kids do what then what she does. Good, good. All right. Who'd you all have?
We had the college.
College or high school student.
Yeah. So, first thing we had was, do you write or say what you believe or really believe when a professor or a teacher asks like for an assignment, or do you write what they want to hear, whether or not it's about religion or something like that. Second one was, you have a group of friends who are doing poorly in a class and they decide to cheat, and you don't, you decide to turn them in or not. And then you're a resident assistant, you have a bisexual hall director who asks you to sign and affirm that you'll be an ally for the LGBTQ community.
Good.
Yeah.
Good, good examples. Good. All right, what do you got? Who do you have? Neighborhood. No, relatives.
Morning.
Oh, I see how I can start with this.
Okay, the parents are split. One is a believer, one's not. And the child is grown up not believing. And they get married and they don't want you to attend their wedding.
Who doesn't want to attend the wedding?
So in the specific case, parents are split. One is a believer, one's not. They both raised the same child. He's getting married.
The child is getting married.
The child is getting married. He doesn't want the believing parents to be at the wedding.
He doesn't want the believing parents to be at the wedding.
Yes.
Who blames them for the split?
Blames for the split or doesn't believe.
Doesn't believe.
It wants a secular wedding instead of a...
All right. Good. Got another one?
Parents going into ministry and the family's upset because they're taking their children away, don't understand why you're... And so why are you keeping my grandkids from me when you know, at Christmas time? It's because you're working ministry.
My wife's sister wants to know if they can have her daughter's marriage in our backyard. We have a large backyard with landscaping. It's attractive and would handle a small wedding. Wants to know if our backyard would be available for basically our niece's wedding. Now, our niece is a believer, as far as we know, but it's clear that she's not going to be marrying a believer. The boy is pretty clear he's not interested at all in these things. Now, the biblical command is believers are not to marry unbelievers. Do I want that kind of a marriage to be performed in my backyard in front of my impressionable kids? No. I cannot celebrate something that God said should not be occurring. I don't want my kids to think mom and dad don't care whether we marry believers or not because they had our cousin marry an unbeliever in their backyard. So we tried to explain as nice as we can to my wife's sister, we cannot give permission for that marriage. And we tried to give the reasons why that we're trying to follow what God is saying. We're trying to protect our children from thinking there's no big deal if I go that same direction. No, it is a big deal. Mom and dad will not support us either in going that direction. But boy, will they cause some estrangement between the sisters. So you've got those kinds of problems. Yeah. All right. These are really good. Okay. You see that when you do it, everybody connects visually with the picture that you have presented because it's a real life picture that they know is happening. You don't have to have actual examples. It doesn't have to be something that has happened. It just needs to be something that does happen, that could happen, that maybe will happen, and you are forewarning or forearming them. Now, in many cases, it will be something that is happening in their life right now, and you are bringing God's grace to them and pointing them in the right direction. But nothing happens apart from specifics. Okay? All right, we're due for a break. If you use 5 minutes, which is stretch, go to the bathroom, get another drink of water, come back at 7:25, 5 minutes, and I'll have you on your way by 7:45. Okay? Let's do that. Take a break. Thank you.
Okay, I'll invite everybody to find your seats again. Come back for our final session here. Should I? Okay. Who's come the farthest tonight? I should probably... Don Sunukjian's come the farthest? Ben Hosh, I mean, you're kind of... Where are you residing?
My mailing residence is still in Taiwan.
Should we give it to Taiwan? Is that? Give it to California, the speaker?
There's a winner right there.
Taiwan, man.
If you're not even like advocating for yourself, then it's going to Taiwan. Welcome, Ben Hosh. This is the 20-ounce black travel mug for your long travels. Enjoy. And we'll welcome back Don Sunukjian.
All right. Let's go to the top of page 4. Top of page 4. There is a difference between illustrating and applying. An illustration is a picture, but it's not from their lives. It is from some other area of life, okay? It's geese flying through the air in a V formation. Yeah, that's an illustration, I don't know of what, but it's. Another example would be it's the pastor saying something, oh, may God give us men of courage, like the Civil War general who was leading a cavalry charge with a saber in his hand on a horse saying, follow me, men, and his horse was shot out from under him, and he rolled off. He picked the saber up. He said, follow me, men, and on foot he led a charging cow. God give us men of courage like that. Pastor, I don't own a sword. I cannot visualize a time when I will be leading charging horses on foot. It's not my life. It's an illustration. Illustrations are interesting. Sometimes they are fun. They accomplish very little spiritually because they're not real life. Pastor, you want to talk about courage? You want to talk about courage? I'll tell you what to talk about. Monday morning, tomorrow, 2:00, I have an appointment. In my office, two attorneys are going to show up. And they're going to take a deposition of me. You know what a deposition is, Pastor. They're going to ask me questions, and whatever I answer, my answers can come out in the trial. Okay? One of the ladies in my office is suing our boss for sexual harassment, and I know she has a case. I saw him put his hands where they ought not to be. They're going to ask me what I know about it. If I tell the truth, and I'm under oath to tell the truth, and they quote me in the trial, what do you think my future is with this company? Huh? Talk about courage now. If I say I don't know anything, I save my neck, but I play false to her and I lie. Talk about courage, Pastor. Talk about courage. Now you're in his life or her life, okay? I heard a student talk about the Bereans. They searched the scriptures. And he said, like I searched my car when I thought I lost my wedding ring. I didn't know where it was. I thought it was, I looked, I went through the seats. No, I looked under the floorboard. I even lifted the seat out to see if it had fallen back in. When he got all through, I thought, I know how to search a car, but I don't know how to search the scriptures. You didn't give me a picture that showed me how to do that, okay? Suppose you're preaching from Timothy. Paul writes to Timothy and he says, Timothy, there are some people in your church, their goal is to get rich in life. They have a picture of the house that they're going to own, the stocks that they're going to build investments in. They're going to take European vacations. They're going to send their kids to Ivy League schools. They're going to retire at 50, 55. Their goal is to get wealthy. That's their goal. They have a love of money, and that driving force in their life is going to be their downfall. They're going to fall into temptations in order to make that happen. They're going to get into traps. They're going to do foolish things, sinful things. It will plunge them spiritually into ruin and destruction. The love of money is a root which will grow into all kinds of evil within them. They will pierce themselves with that. The love of money will be your downfall. And you tell the story of Yusuf the Terrible Turk. True story. In the 1940s, he came over from Turkey. Yusuf the Terrible Turk, that was his wrestling name, came over to wrestle the American champion, who at that time was named Ed Strangler Lewis. And Ed Strangler Lewis got his name not because he did a chokehold, which was illegal, but he did a headlock where he would get around your head and he would put the pressure on until eventually you just got into a swoon and he would put you on the mat and he would get a pin count. And no matter what you do, once he got that lock, you couldn't break it. You could pick him up, you could roll him around, he'd go with it, but it kept tightening and tightening and tightening. Well, the difficulty was when Yusuf came over, Yusuf had such a big head, Ed couldn't get the lock. And Yusuf bounced him around like a rubber ball, won the match, and afterward was waiting to get his prize money. So they wanted, the promoters, they wanted to write him a check for his prize money. And Yusuf looked at the piece of paper, said, "Piece of paper, no good, my village." Okay. Well, how about dollars? No spend dollars here in Turkey. What do you need? Lira. Well, we can't put our hands on that much lira. Your boat sails tomorrow. What can we do? Gold. Okay, America is still on the gold standard. We can get enough, we got enough gold. And so Yusuf was given a bag of a lot of gold coins for his prize money. He bought a money belt with a slit on the inside and he stuffed those gold coins all the way around. And so he's got a heavy money belt of gold coins. He gets on the boat to go across the Atlantic. There's not much air travel at this point. Everything is still pretty much by Atlantic, by boat. And when he gets on, they want, you want to put that in the ship's safe. Mm-hmm. He's not sure that sticky fingers wouldn't pick a few gold pieces out as it was going in and out of the safe. And he's not, well, nobody's going to mess with you, that's a terrible term. So he's got this gold belt. Well, about a half a day out, this boat develops engine problems and is dead in the water. Okay. Another boat's going to have to come out from New York, and they're going to have to transfer everybody from the dead boat to the new liner that's going to take them across. And so they've got this small Aviso boat that's making the transfer, okay? And as Yusuf gets ready to step off of the boat that he's on, onto the small boat that's going to transfer him, all of a sudden the small, the water, the wave, tidal wave, moves that boat out, and he has committed his weight, and that's the last anybody ever heard of Yusuf the Terrible Turk. The love of money will be your downfall. Pastor, I'll remember that the next time I win a wrestling championship and I'm wearing a gold belt crossing the Atlantic. Now, would I tell that story in a sermon? Yes. It's funny. It's interesting. Did it accomplish anything spiritually in terms of them being concerned about the love? No, it's not their life. I tell it, but I would not fool myself into thinking I had been relevant. I have only been interesting and funny. If I'm going to be relevant, if I'm going to make connections to contemporary situations in their life, where do I point to the love of money being their downfall? What would I talk about? The love of money, the desire to get wealthy, it could be your downfall. Where would it show up in their lives?
Taking, you know, yet another promotion that's going to keep you more hours and good. Away from your family. And
good. At the expense of the family.
Kids are growing up.
Good.
Valueless, all that.
Good. Give me another one.
Wasting money on the lottery.
Good. Give me another one.
Stock market crashes.
Good. Another one. Credit card debt, where you can barely make the minimum payment and not do, and even dent the principal. The principal goes up every year, every month. Okay. Fighting over inheritance. Okay. None is it. All right. That's where the love of money is the downfall in our contemporary life. So your goal is always to say, what does it look like? How does it show up in real life situations? An application is an example or a picture from the exact situation of the life of your listener. Okay? Paul writes, if someone is caught in a sin, and the implication there is they didn't intend to do it, they were pressured into it, under the spur of the moment, they did something they knew was wrong, they hoped they would get away with it, and they're caught. They're caught. They're caught in a sin. All right, you who are spiritual, you restore them. And the word restore was used in the medical industry to set a broken bone, to bring it back to usefulness so that it could function like it should, to strength. It was also used in the fishing industry to mend a net that had been snagged as it was pulled up and a hole was ripped in and fish were streaming out through that hole, and to restore it was to mend the net. So the picture is of restoring, bringing something back to usefulness. And you say, that's what we need to do. Okay, when somebody is caught, we need to restore them to fellowship and to usefulness. And at the end of the sermon, your Sunday school superintendent comes up to you and says, Pastor, good sermon, good. I know how we can restore Susie. Susie is the 16-year-old girl who, under the pressure of a backseat and a boyfriend, found herself pregnant and is now showing at 7 or 8 months. What do you have in mind, Mr. Sunday School Superintendent, to restore? We've been looking for a teacher of the sixth grade girls' Sunday school class. Let's ask Susie to be, the pastor's getting a picture of this 8-month pregnant girl teaching 12-year-olds. She said, Mr. Sunday School Superintendent, I'm not sure that's what I had in mind. Well, Pastor, what did you have in mind? I don't know. Susie's not a broken bone. She's not a ripped net. She's a pregnant girl. What does it look like in real life to restore somebody in our congregation? The best example I saw of that, I was preaching in a church and the pastor was there and he said, Don, when you finish preaching, would you mind just taking a seat right here in the front row? Today is the day we take in new members. And I'll come up and I'll call the names of all of the new members that are going to be coming up, and they'll line up down the row here. And then I'll ask the congregation to come down and, right hand of fellowship and welcome them into the church, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Sure. So I finished preaching and I went and I sat down, and he came up and he did that. He called the names of all the couples and families and singles. They all just lined up. And then he said to the congregation, in a minute, I'm going to ask you to come and welcome them into the church. Tell them you're glad they're here, that you think that God will bless them, and you hope that we will be a blessing in their life also. In a minute. But before I ask you to do that, there's somebody else I want you to welcome back into our church. Anna, would you come? And she was on the aisle. She knew this was happening. And she came and she stood right by him, directly in front of me. And she was, and he explained, he didn't ask her to talk. He explained that she had met with the leaders of the church. There had been confession and repentance. And she was coming back to the church that she had been brought up in. She wanted to be part of the church. She hoped that some of you older women would give her motherly counsel and godly counsel as she's trying to raise this child. In the absence of a husband, she hoped some of you men would take it to be a father figure of some sort to the child, so that the child would have some male role models also. And I'm going to ask you, when you welcome these people, to welcome Anna back into our church. Now, would you come and do that? And they started down where they were supposed to, and they went boom, 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 and boom. The line balled up right in front of Anna, because they knew Anna. They didn't know any of these people. These are all new people, okay? They stopped in front of Anna, many of them who knew them. I saw one businessman bring a business card out of his wallet and say, Anna, I work for a pharmaceutical manufacturing company. If your doctor prescribes any medicines, you call me. I can probably get you samples, okay? I heard a woman lean into her and whisper, I have some baby clothes up in the attic. He thinks we're going to have another baby, but we're not. We're not. Anna was being restored to the congregation. Okay? Now, if you ever face a situation like that in your church, you don't need to look at any notes. The Spirit of God has put a picture in your mind, a picture which you will put before your congregation. That's concrete, that's specific. That's when relevancy occurs. Daniel suggested that there might be a couple of minutes open for questions, if that's of interest to you.
I'll grab the mic.
You want to get a mic?
Yeah, we are thankful for Don, and we'll make a little time for questions. We'll try to use the microphone for our online participants as well. Thanks.
I really appreciate this, as opposed to like just ivory tower ideas and so on. This is really down, it's concrete, relevant. My point is, how well is a pastor going to have to get to know his sheep, so to speak, get the people, the ones that are he's leading and shepherding? You almost have to know your people to be able to do what you're talking about, don't you? I mean, the Holy Spirit can prompt you about the specific exact situations of the people you're going to speak to. I think that can happen too in your preparation, but it really helps if you know your people.
It does.
In these exact kind of ways, doesn't it?
I made a regular practice of asking men out to lunch, and I would just talk about their jobs, their lives, their families, and in many cases I would go from lunch with them back to their work so that I could see their work. And they were quite pleased to introduce their pastor to people at work. So I really tried to do that. Our church would have a small group ministry. I was one of the small groups, so every week I was at least with a dozen people to do that. It's not hard, though, to rummage around in life because you share the same experiences, just like we did. You may not know what's going on, but they might. Now, your question prompted something very necessary to say. In a small church, you cannot talk about a situation that is going on that other people know is going on. The last thing you want is for people listening to you to be, okay, you can't do that. In a larger church, that's less of a danger. Because first of all, the person knows that you don't know that about them. They know you're visualizing it, but you didn't have them in mind because they know you don't know that about their circumstances. Or they know that nobody else does, even if you might. And I would always try to couch it in terms where, if I wanted to encourage the person but not expose them, I would say something along the lines of, chairman of our board one time showed up early at my house for a board meeting, and he was distraught. He had just come from his company. He was the owner of a marble granite company, and his treasurer, his controller, through malfeasance, not through wickedness, but through stupidity, had lost $1 million for the company. And this was going to be the end of the company. He could not recover from that kind of a loss. And my heart just went out to him. And I found myself a couple of months later saying, if somebody you trusted has been false to you or disappointed you. Now, I didn't use anything that anybody else in the congregation could identify with, but he could identify with it, as could every divorced person in the congregation. The language was such that everybody could plug a real experience into it. But I would never use something that would call attention to somebody in the church. But you can get to know the people in different ways. Yeah. But it's surprising if you just listen to the news or if you read a news magazine, how much of the world's travails you pick up. Good question.
So I really love this. So thank you very much for enlightening me about relevance. My question is, when you're preaching as a pastor, you're preaching to a group of people. So I'm just wondering, how can you bring in specific situations into preaching that, like, I'm thinking with this, it's not always going to, some people aren't going to connect with this. So should you like specialize for, like, just think about this one person, or how do you like connect to all the people with these specific examples?
Usually I try to have, if I'm going to start off with talking about persecution for righteousness' sake, I'll probably give one from a widow, one from a college student, one from a young mom, I'll try to give one example fairly detailed from different demographics within the congregation so that everybody has a chance to connect with something. Now, sometimes I can describe one situation and somebody else, it's not exactly their situation, but it's close enough that they glom onto it. I might describe a situation of a woman who works for an entrepreneur. He's developed a computer program that for the medical industry. Hospitals use it for their billing and staffing, etc. And once a hospital buys into it, all the doctors around there, they buy into the same computer program. Well, he's supposed to show up back at the office to demonstrate this program to a hospital administrator who's coming in for a 2 o'clock appointment. And he got hung up somewhere. He calls his secretary, Helen, and he says, tell the guy, the hospital administrator, I'm on my way. I'll be there within a few minutes. And she says, well, where are you? And he gives a location that is an hour and a half away. She says, you're not going to be here in a few minutes. He says, well, you tell him that, because otherwise he'll get so mad, he'll leave. We'll never get another chance to sell. She says, Tom, I can't lie for you. You lie for me, or I'll get somebody on that phone who can. Okay. Now, she is being asked to tell a lie. If she acts unrighteously, she's on her way out, okay? Now, I got a man sitting on the other side of the room. He's not a woman, he doesn't work for an entrepreneur. He has access to the books of his company, and he's being asked to create a double set of books for the sake of the home office, because they are part of a national corporation and they got to send in a good report to the home office so that his boss looks good. Now, he hears that example, and he suddenly realizes that's the same situation I'm in. I'm being asked to lie. Okay, so he can connect with it, even though I did not describe his kind of a situation. I described something close enough. Now, did I come at your question, or did you have something else in mind?
I just remembered at the beginning you of this packet it's number 3 on the second page. It says the listener usually doesn't make the application himself. So I was just curious about that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. You have to present the visual picture.
Yeah. Thank you so much for everything you've been talking about your application. It's got my mind. I like this idea of rummaging around in, you know, people's lives and just kind of getting in their heads. My question is, you know, I think of the way that Jesus taught in parables, and some of the parables that he taught, it was almost like a mic drop kind of thing. He would say something for shock value, and then he would kind of drop the microphone and get out of there. And he wouldn't make the direct application. He wouldn't directly connect to people's lives like intentionally. And that was kind of the power of the parable. So I guess my question is there a place for that sort of teaching preaching? Is that in line with what you've kind of been advocating for? Or where does that parabolic approach fit in?
Yeah. Yes. Your observation is true some of the time. I think other times he drew the point. So you watch and wait. You do not know when the master will return, when the Lord will return. So there was the point was drawn. Be ready, be on faith. The other time he would point them to scenarios in the Old Testament which carried the truth that he wanted. This is why you ought to look at the Old Testament in terms of theological truths, not just nice stories. The Pharisee said to him one time, "What you're doing on the Sabbath is not lawful. Why are you acting well, doing what you're doing on the Sabbath?" Okay? His answer to them was, he pointed to an event in the Old Testament that had taken place 1,000 years earlier. "Have you never read how David ate the sacred bread from the tabernacle that only the high priest was supposed to eat? And in fact, the high priest gave it to him. If you had read that account and understood the point behind that account, you would have known why I do what I do on the Sabbath." So he was saying to them, you ought to have looked at the scriptures with enough depth and discernment and insight to realize God was revealing eternal truths, not just historical events. And I think that some of what Jesus is doing is the same thing. Jesus also said somewhere, or it was said, he spoke to them in parables so that those who had ears to hear would hear, and those who did not would not. So, like Isaiah said, "Being having ears, you do not hear, but you are blind." So in some way, his parabolic approach was to hide the truth from those whose hearts were hard, and to open and to know that his followers would be able to pick up on it. Yes.
So in the scenario that we worked out in our small groups, you had talked about how do we apply this truth of persecution for righteousness' sake to these certain groups. How much in your own sermon preparation has it kind of got, like, is the tail wagging the dog in the selection of the theme or passage for that Sunday? Like, I see something happening in my congregation, and therefore we're going to do this text?
No.
Or, you're right? Like, I feel like that would be a really frantic.
Yeah, no. The preparation always starts with a deep immersion in commentaries to understand the biblical passage.
And even the selection of the biblical passage.
Huh?
Even when you start with the selection of the biblical passage.
Yeah, I would say 2/3 of the time I'm in a series through a biblical book. So the selection is pretty set as I move. The other time I'm usually in some kind of a series where I have mapped out the series, and I usually know my selections pretty far in advance. My preparation time is to thoroughly immerse myself in the study of the scripture until I know the flow of thought and the central theological truth. Then I go in search for, good question.
So I had read through Bo Yeerts. There's a translation of his sermons. And Bo Yeerts, he was a bishop of the church in Sweden. And I think it was the nature of his job that he's the bishop and he's going to these different churches. But kind of to a T, his sermons always ended with application, but he kind of had three layers. So first layer was to people who are not Christians. How does this text apply to them? Second layer was Christians, but weak in the faith. And then the third are Christians who are delighting in the Lord. I mean, in light of kind of our current cultural climate and our churches, like, is that kind of a worthy place to be?
That's interesting. Yeah. I've not thought along those lines.
Yeah.
I tend to think that most of the people that I'm talking to are believers, and most of them have been part of this church for a good number of years, and they have an openness to what the scripture is saying, and I'm more inclined to go demographically as we described. I would be interested in that approach if there was a specificity I think that it can't be just, you know, you need to learn to trust the Lord more. No, that's not helpful. That's vague. If he gave concrete, you know, examples of what that would look like, then I would be interested in seeing that kind of a tier. It's an interesting approach. Good. All right. I thank you very much. My goodness, it's been a delight to be in Fergus Falls. Beautiful, beautiful town. I enjoyed the drive from Fargo all the way across here yesterday afternoon. Saw those open fields of harvested material. And I particularly have enjoyed seeing the turning of the trees. We don't get that where I live. Thank you very much.